Hi everyone and welcome to this video. I'm Prateek, dentist and specialty doctor, and in this video we're going to be looking at the interview process for dental core training during the COVID pandemic. So in this video we'll be looking at what the interview process for dental core training will be during the COVID pandemic, the types of stations that will be involved, and some hints and tips in order to maximise the mark you can get through an online interview. I have done some other videos on the dental core training process, so make sure you have a look at those. Before we go on, it's really important to stress that this is a fluid situation, as I've said in other videos, so make sure you stay up to date with the COPDEND website where all the details are listed. As it currently stands, plan A that is put forward by COPDEND is that you will have an interview which will be carried out on Microsoft Teams with two examiners. If the pandemic gets worse, this may be dropped to plan B, where there'll just be a single examiner. Different to previous years, you will have two stations. The first one is a clinical governance station, and the second one a clinical scenario station. Each of these stations account for 33.5% of your overall mark. The SJTs account for 33%. The interview is a stark contrast to the situational judgment test. In the SJTs, you're not really tested on your clinical knowledge, whereas in the interview, you need your clinical knowledge to shine. For those of you who have previously applied to dental core training or have looked at old application guides, you'll be aware that they normally would be a communication station. But due to the pandemic, this isn't going to happen this year. So instead, your communication is likely to be assessed from these other stations. So it's really important that you remember to maintain good communication skills. Each station is thought to approximately be lasting for 7.5 minutes, giving you a total 15-minute interview time. We're still unclear as to whether you'll get the scenarios beforehand or you'll get some reading time at the time. Again, ensure that you read the person's specification, because there are certain things that would be expected you know when it comes to these scenarios. Although you may not know completely which scenario is going to come up, you can have a good guess, and there are certain themes and certain topics that will likely come up, and so it's really important you look at these topics and you consider potential answers for them. Now, if we look at Station 1, this is officially titled as Clinical Governance, Quality Improvement and Professional Skills. The complexity of this will probably vary slightly between DCT 1 and DCT 2 and 3 applications, where at DCT 2 and 3 you're expected to have a little more knowledge. There are potentially lots of things that you may need to cover in this station, but a lot of this comes with documentation guidelines that are readily available for you to read. Make sure you read the relevant resources, including the GDC standards, FGDP guidelines, looking at the 7 pillars of clinical governance, aspects of evidence-based practice, scope of practice, safeguarding, consent, the list goes on. There are so many things that you could look at. Some examples of stations that could potentially come up or it's worth practicing: consenting for a 16-year-old and how you would go about this, what to do if you suspect that someone has been abused and they turn up as a patient, what to do in terms of auditing, so the audit cycle. You may also be asked to draw on your own experience. So if you're asked about audits, you may be asked to tell them about an audit that you've done. So making sure you follow each of the steps of the audit cycle in order to present it properly to the examiners. You can use jargon in this station, because you're not speaking to a patient, you're speaking to examiners. So use jargon, demonstrate your knowledge, demonstrate the terms that you know and the documents that you know. These will pick you up the extra marks. And if there is time left at the end and you feel like you've spoken everything that you can always go back and fill in bits that you may have forgotten. Take your time, compose yourself, and look back on the topics. Let's look at the second station, which is the clinical scenario. In this station, you're going to be presented with a clinical situation, and you're expected to demonstrate your clinical knowledge and competency through this. Typically, you will go through the assessment, your diagnosis, your investigations, and also your treatment planning. Common stations to consider for this include common things that you'd see as a DCT: facial trauma, fractures of the mandible or fractures of the zygoma, a dentoalveolar trauma and a vulse tooth and how you'd manage this, advanced periodontal disease and how you'd manage this type of patient. You may also be asked about osteoradionecrosis or medication-related osteonecrosis of the jaw, emerange. If you're thinking about practicing this station, look at common situations you've come across in dental school or during your foundation year, or what you're likely to come across, for example, if you were to do a max fax DCT job. Then you discuss the case with the examiners in the format that I've already mentioned. It's important to follow this systematic format to try and maximize the marks you will get, because you're less likely to skip things. Another really important thing with this is to know your limitations. Ultimately, for example, if you have a station regarding a fractured mandible, there is only so much you're going to be competent to do as a dental core trainee. And this is when you would start mentioning that you would speak to your registrar on call, or you'd speak to your consultant on call. call to get their input. This does two things. It shows that you are safe and it shows that you're working within your competency and you recognize your limits. Don't forget to go through an ABCDE assessment. If it is a patient, for example, who's attended A&E or has sustained trauma, this again shows that you're not forgetting the basics. You've got a well-rounded view of the situation at hand. Discuss all treatment options and how you'd go about making an informed decision with the patient. The scenario should fall within your knowledge and it's useful to involve evidence-based practice wherever you can. For example, if a station comes on wisdom teeth, you may want to start referencing the NICE guidelines on extraction of wisdom teeth. The last thing to mention specifically for the clinical scenario, if you don't know, admit that you don't know. This is the safest option and the safest thing to say. Now we've looked at the two main stations, I want to give you a couple of tips on structuring your answers. There are two ways that I find it really easy to structure answers. The first way, if you're encountering something that is involving competency, qualities, or skills,
is using the mnemonic
START. So we have situation, and this provides a summary of the context of the answer. We've got the task, which explains what you are required to do. We've got the action, which explains what you did and why you did it, and this will show your involvement and competency. And the result, so the outcome of your action, including a reflection. Then for ethical and professionalism scenarios,
another mnemonic
is SPIES, and this is broken down to seeking information, this demonstrating you learning more about the situation, so what is actually happening, patient safety, is patient care compromised, initiative, what can you do yourself to help the situation, escalate, this is involving other colleagues, bodies, etc. For example, if you've got a staff member working out of their scope of practice, you may want to involve a practice manager. And support, how can you support the individual, the team, and the patient? Using these two methods, it means that you're likely to follow, again, a structured approach, and so you're less likely to miss things when it comes to answering the questions. Let's now look at the big thing, the general tips on how to get the most from an online interview. The first thing, whether it's online or not, are buzzwords. A lot of the marks that are available are simply for saying buzzwords. So for example, if you have a vulnerable child, it's saying the term safeguarding. Or if you've got someone who is doing something they shouldn't be in your team, mentioning scope of practice. So one of the things that I really like to do, particularly for the clinical governance station, in my mind and when I answer to the examiner, the first thing I do is I go through which GDC standards are relevant and which other legal and ethical issues may be involved. An example scenario would be a nurse is carrying out inappropriate treatment on a patient. I immediately go through the GDC standards in my head and I'd start saying to the examiner that there are a number of GDC standards that are impacted but in this scenario. The first being the patient's best interests are affected because they're potentially having inappropriate treatment. And I gradually work through these standards and you can involve majority of the standards. For example, the patient may want to complain. You need to raise concerns because patients are at risk and potentially other members of the team are at risk. So there are lots of ways you can involve the GDC standards. And by saying these buzzwords, you can pick up a lot of the marks. If you spend a lot of time talking about the term but not saying it, you may not get the mark because the examiners don't know for certain you actually know the term. The same with buzzwords applies to the clinical scenario. So for example, if you're discussing investigations for a patient, you use the correct terminology in terms of which radiographs you're going to take, how you're going to assess them. Like with any normal interview, you want to follow the basic principles of an interview. You want to dress appropriately. You also want to ensure that you speak clearly and slowly so that the examiners understand what you're saying. Make sure you've checked that the software works, you've practiced using Microsoft Teams with someone in your family or a friend, because there may be issues such as your internet isn't very stable and so you keep cutting out. These are easy things that you can fix before the interview. Practicing is really important. These are things you can practice. Your friends will have ideas of certain types of stations that may come up, and so practice with them. And you may pick up certain things that you weren't realizing you were doing before. An alternative, if you can't do that at the moment because of the COVID pandemic, is to film yourself. If you film yourself, you'll get a good idea of what you're going to look like over camera. So how your communication is coming across. Are you using verbal and non-verbal communication skills? Because these are all going to be really important in terms of you being assessed on an online interview. Following on from that, you want to be speaking directly to the examiners. And this is something that a lot of people struggle with an online interview. A lot of people will stare at their screen rather than staring into the camera. But to actually make eye contact as you would in a normal interview with the examiners, you need to look directly into the camera. Make sure you practice this so that this doesn't feel unnatural to you. Other basic things with regards to preparing for your interview. Find a quiet room that doesn't have any distractions. Choose a neutral background so that the examiners are put off during your interview and you can be seen clearly. Make sure your laptop is working and is fully charged, or you have your charger available to you. Again, this is not something you want to stress about. And finally, if you make a mistake, don't worry about it. Either correct yourself or just forget about it and move on. Try not to get flustered and try to relax. This is where practicing becomes really important. The more you practice, the more comfortable you're going to be in this type of situation. If you do have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment or contact me on one of the social handles. If you found this video useful, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe. My recommendation in this video is another YouTuber who is RainaOnTheCusp. Now, Raina is a dental student who is currently at the University of Sheffield. And through a YouTube channel, she's helped a lot of individuals who are currently thinking about dentistry, as well as those currently going through dental school. So if you're interested in this type of thing, make sure you check her YouTube channel. I'll put all the details in the description. Again, if you're sitting the dental core training process, good luck. If you do have any questions, please contact me. I'm happy to help. Till the next video, take care.